In this, as in many verses of Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna is giving an idea of how we can see Him everywhere within the creation. There are several verses in this. As Krishna states earlier in the Bhagavad Gita, Yomam Pashyati Sarvatra, Sarvam Chamay Pashyati, Tasyaham Napanashyami, Sachame Napanashyati. He says that the one who sees me everywhere and everything in me, I am never lost to him, nor is he ever lost to me. This is Krishna consciousness. What does Krishna consciousness mean? Anyone like to get any idea? We speak a lot about Krishna consciousness. What does Krishna consciousness mean?
Srila Prabhupada said, always think of Krishna and never forget him.
Krishna consciousness. To be conscious of Krishna. To be aware of Krishna. To be aware of Krishna. Krishna is everywhere and in everything. Krishna is the support of everything. Nothing can exist without Krishna. Nothing is separate from Krishna. But we are not aware of this. So Krishna consciousness simply means to be aware of Krishna. But that particularly means to be aware of Krishna with love and devotion. It's possible to be Krishna conscious and not be a devotee. How is that possible? Well, we don't teach that process in our movement. But Kamsa, he was also Krishna conscious. He was always thinking of Krishna. Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Manmana, always think of me. So Kamsa was a very good example of someone who was always thinking of Krishna. Hiranyakashipu also. Shishupal also. They were always thinking of Krishna. But the next part of Krishna's instruction, Manmana Bhavamad Bhakto, they didn't follow that part. The next instruction is, Madhyaji Mangnamaskuru, worship me, bow down before me, and that they suddenly didn't want to do. So they were thinking of Krishna constantly, but they were demons, because they were thinking of Krishna in a hateful, a spiteful, nasty way. The Krishna conscious means to think of Krishna with love and devotion, not only to think. Sometimes we've seen devotees, we see them sitting doing nothing, we ask them, well, what are you doing? Because our movement is meant to be a movement. Movement means moving, doing something. So if somebody says, well, I'm thinking of Krishna, well, you can also wash the pots and think of Krishna at the same time. That's even better. Our process is not simply to think of Krishna, but Bhavamad Bhakto, become my devotee, Krishna also says. So there are many yogis in previous ages who sat down and tried to concentrate their minds on Krishna, but that isn't the process recommended in the modern age. It's not even very recommended in any age, but it's especially not recommended in this age. It's recommended that we think of Krishna by studying his glories. Kirtan. Kirtan means glorification. Generally we think of kirtan as singing and dancing. That is kirtan. But the broader meaning of kirtan is glorification. When we chant Hare Krishna, that means we glorify Krishna. When we tell others about Krishna, or we engage in activities meant for spreading glory, the glories of Krishna, that is also kirtan. So our movement is Sankirtan movement. Sankirtan means everyone all together joining together to perform kirtan of Krishna. Now there are many activities. These activities, they help us to remember Krishna, and they're supposed to remind others of Krishna also. It's the most amazing, bewildering potency called Maya, by which we don't remember Krishna. We cannot exist without Krishna, and even though we exist, without remembering Krishna, our existence is meaningless. But we falsely ascribe some meaning to it. Everyone has some, wants to have some meaning or purpose in life. But without making Krishna the purpose of life, which is the real purpose of life, then we adopt so many meaningless and useless things. People think it's very important to have a nice new car. This gives me some meaning. I'm a prestigious person. Or they put so much meaning on sports. Recently they had this World Cup football, and the whole world was crazy about this, and they'll talk about a very important match and a crucial game, and millions of people will be watching. Great attention. But actually, it's, if you see what it is, it's a group of people running around with a ball, and it's not really very important at all. It doesn't have any real importance at all. And it doesn't really make that much difference whether the ball goes this way or that way, but only because we've ascribed some meaning to it. We think it's very important. It doesn't really affect anything in our lives. But only we've ascribed some meaning to it. That our country is better than your country if our football team can beat your football team. But it doesn't mean that one country is better than another. And what is the meaning even of one country being better than another? What is the meaning to that? Only because we identify with this country. Everyone has a strong sense of national pride. Croatia at the moment, this is very strong, I believe. We have gained independence after so many years. So what's the great benefit? And after some time, someone will come and invade, or maybe Croatia will get a big army and invade everybody else. You never know. At one time, Lithuania ruled a large portion of Europe. You know that? At one time, Lithuania, they were very. And so now, 700 years later, they still remember their glorious past. This is all meaningless. Everything in material life is meaningless. Our pleasures and our pains, they're all meaningless. We take pleasure if a child is born, and we are pained if our relative dies. But these things must happen in material life. Yeah, this is the land of birth and death. And ultimately we have no relationship with husband, father, mother, wife, children. We do have a relationship, with Krishna. But on the bodily platform, it's meaningless. Therefore Krishna says here, Pitaham asya jagatam. I am the father of the universe. If we see we have our father, naturally we're attached to our father, mother, maybe not so much in the modern days, but normally people are attached. But Krishna is recommending, actually that attachment should be for me. Because they are our well-wishers. When we're young and we can't even move or walk, we can't even eat, as a parent, mother is feeding us, father is working hard to bring money to buy food and so many different things. And when we don't behave properly, then the father disciplines us. And in this way, the father and mother, they bring us up. So naturally we feel grateful because they have given so much to us. But Krishna is pointing out that he is the real father and he is the real mother. That whatever qualities are in a father or mother or any person who is kind to us, they are reflections of Krishna's original kindness. This concept of God as the father is very prominent in the Christian religion. Here also, Dhata, this has been translated here as creator. God the creator. God is the creator of the universe. Now, people in general, they have a they don't have spiritual knowledge. So they think that this material world is some place for us to enjoy. So they think God is the creator of this universe and he's created it for us to enjoy. This misunderstanding leads to many theological mistakes. Just like, for instance, it is said in the Bible, in Genesis, that God gave man dominion over the animals. In the Bible, in Genesis, it is stated that God gave man dominion, that means lordship over the animals. So some Christian theologians, they have interpreted this to mean that God gave man charge of the animals, and life is meant to enjoy, and we can enjoy eating meat, so we should kill the animals and eat them. Actually, many Christians in history have been against this idea. They've been vegetarians and against animal slaughter. But in course of time, this actually demoniac and ungodly idea has come that God has given us this world to enjoy. Therefore, we should enjoy it by eating flesh and so on. But this comes from a lack of proper spiritual knowledge. Any spiritual teacher, including the great Lord Jesus Christ included, they teach us to come out of this world and go to Godhead, to the spiritual world. So here, Krishna claims himself as the creator of the world. But this is stated here in Bhagavad Gita, but there's also the news of the spiritual world is also given. Although he is the creator of this material world is not a very important place compared to the spiritual world. We can see, here Krishna is giving the idea how to see him everywhere. He is the creator of this world. So everywhere we see so many wonders in nature, we can remember Krishna has created this. How wonderful is Krishna? So that is a way to begin to see Krishna. But his real glory is not that he has created this material world. This material world is very insignificant compared to the spiritual world. So Krishna is giving us some indication of his true glories by giving us some indication of how we can recognize him here in this material world. This is called Shakha Chandra Nyaya, or the logic of seeing the moon through the branches of a tree. If the parent wants to show this is the moon to the child. So the parent may say, you see between these two branches of the tree, there is that big shining light, that is the moon. In other words, something which is close and easily recognized, you show that first, and then you show something else which is less easy to recognize in relation to that. So Krishna is the creator of this material world, but this material world is not actually the important place. Even with all its history, so many great personalities of this material world, you have Napoleon and Hitler and Tito and so many big famous people, they're actually not very important. Nowadays there's a lot of talk about cataclysm and so many things, and the astrologers in 1996 they said it'll be in 1997, in 1997 they said it's going to be in 98. Anyway, they're always predicting that just now coming. Cataclysm is just now coming. Well, even if it does, it's only the material world. In this material world, there's always destruction going on. Just like you see sometimes in the newspaper, airplane disaster, 100 people killed. But actually, every day, there's hundreds and thousands of people dying all over the world. Someone dies, so many people die of old age, car accidents, young babies die, they don't survive childbirth, sometimes the mothers die also from diseases. Not an uncommon thing that someone is just walking around normally and then all of a sudden he's got a pain in his stomach and 1 hour later he's dead. Yes, I saw this once. One of our devotees, he was doing his service, he had a terrible pain in his stomach, they took him to hospital and he was dead in 1 hour. One time we were in someone's house and the lady of the house was serving us prasad, and then all of a sudden she had a heart attack and died. Now you don't want to see me, that is dangerous person. Anyway, the point is that so many people are dying all the time. If you see the airplane crash, 100 people killed, because they're all killed in one place at one time, they think it's something very severe. But actually, if you see every day how many thousands of people are dying. So there's always, this material world is a place of cataclysm. All the time people are dying. From time to time there are bigger disasters. At the end of Kali Yuga, Kalki comes, and for the materialistic people that's a disaster. At the end of the day of Lord Brahma, then there's destruction over most of the universe. At the end of the life of Brahma, the whole universe is dissolved. So this material world is the place of destruction and death. But the spiritual world, that is the abode of Krishna, that is his own personal abode. He's also here in the material world, but only to guide us back to the spiritual world. So Krishna is giving some indication of his presence in the material world, but his aim and object is to guide us back to the spiritual world, where life is very nice. There are no cataclysms, no disasters. There's only dancing, chanting and feasting, no fasting. Sudhitanartane Shapashati Vame Tushite Shobhavane. There's very nice singing, Sudhitana, very nice dancing. So all the cowherd boys and gopis and beautiful forests of Vrindavan. It's Krishna, eternal. So many nice pastimes are going on. So Krishna is giving us some indication that you won't be the loser. Whatever you do in this material world, you're always the loser. Whatever you get, you lose it all. Everyone's a loser. In English there's a phrase, born loser. Have you ever heard that? Do you have that in Croatian also? Born loser. Whatever you do, it's a failure. So everyone in this material world is a born loser. See, even your Napoleon, he conquered so many places. At the end he got smashed and he had to drink horse's urine on the battlefield and so many things. He was humiliated in so many ways. See, now Bill Gates is famous as the richest man in the world. Although I think there's probably people who are richer than him, but they just don't say, they hide it away. Anyway, whatever he's got, he's going to lose it all his billions of dollars. He's not going to be able to take 1 cent with him. Whatever you have, even if it's only some dirty old t-shirt and a pair of jeans, but you have to lose that also. You can't take anything with you. Whatever you get, you have to lose it. So Krishna is telling us, don't be attached to anything because you can't keep it anyway. The only thing worth being attached to is Krishna, because if you're attached to Krishna, that we won't lose. Krishna will remain with us. Even if we don't become perfect in this life, Krishna will give us the chance in the next life. Neha bhikkhu anasya sri pativayana vidyate svabhimapyasya dharmasya trayate mahatogaya. Krishna says, whatever advancement you make in Krishna consciousness, that is permanent and eternal. In this endeavor, there is no loss or diminution, and even a slight advancement on this path can protect one from the greatest trouble. There is no loss to be Krishna conscious. You don't have to spend any money to be Krishna conscious. You can chant Hare Krishna, walking on the street. What do you lose? The atheist may say, well, why are you chanting? What is this? Believing God, chanting Hare Krishna. They'll say, life is just meant for enjoyment. So he'll say, well, we're happy. Why all this belief in God? So what's your philosophy? Well, when you die, everything is finished, so you should enjoy life now. But we're happy. But they will say, you're an illusion. What does it matter? If you die and everything's finished, it doesn't matter whether you're an illusion. What's the reality? If your philosophy is right, and when the body is finished and everything is finished, then it doesn't matter anyway what you do, because everything's finished after a short time anyway. So anyway, if you are happy by performing every single activity you can imagine, we'll be happy like that, and we're happy chanting Hare Krishna. And if your philosophy is right, then when the body is finished, everything is finished, then it doesn't make any difference anyway. But if our philosophy is right, then we're chanting Hare Krishna, and we go back to Krishna. You don't go back to Krishna, you go the other direction. So anyway, you have nothing to lose. And actually, it's not a question of my opinion, your opinion. Devotees experience Krishna. Krishna is reality. It's not simply some blind faith. Krishna consciousness is something which devotees experience. Otherwise, how can we go on chanting Hare Krishna? There's no material sound that you can go on repeating again and again and again. How can devotees take so much pleasure in chanting the same mantra? Because the name of Krishna is Krishna, as Krishna is unlimited and blissful. So the name of Krishna is unlimitedly blissful. So we do more or less the same things. We chant the same mantra. We read the same books. We discuss the same philosophy. But it doesn't become boring. It's not that, you know, well, I got fed up with chanting Hare Krishna. Let's chant something else. Om Hari Om Durga Shiva Ram Hari Ram. You can make up so many things. But we don't need to. We chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was chanting Hare Krishna, and screams of tears were coming from his eyes and making everyone wet like a syringe. He was experiencing such ecstasy. So Krishna Chaitanya means Krishna consciousness. Chaitanya means consciousness. So Krishna Chaitanya means Krishna consciousness. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is Krishna consciousness personified. He's showing us by his own example how to relish chanting the holy names, how to remember Krishna. Hare Krishna. Tomorrow is Janmashtami. It's a day simply for remembering Krishna. By the grace of Mother Maria, I think everyone has a holiday tomorrow. So we can all utilize the opportunity to chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. And hear about Krishna and fast. Prepare so many preparations for Krishna. And in this way, happily. Actually, this will be the 24th Janmashtami I'm celebrating. I've only been in the same place. I mean, I was in Dhaka, Bangladesh twice. Otherwise, every time a different place. So this time I'll be in Chakovec and Zagreb. Krishna willing. I mean, I could also... I didn't survive that long yet, but I hope... You don't know. I mean, let's say I will do this and I will do it. You should always remember that. So Krishna willing... I'll be able to chant Hare Krishna here tomorrow morning and then in the afternoon in Zagreb also. Hare Krishna, is there any question, please?
Zato se Buhari više tebo ima nekosicira bivanje omkare.
We chanted it here just a few minutes ago. We're always chanting. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale. Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami. We regularly chant Om. We don't chant Om as our principal meditation. We chant Hare Krishna Maha Mantra as our principal meditation. But it's not that we don't chant Om. Here we have in this verse, Vedam Pavitram Omkara. Krishna says that in the Vedas I am the all pure Omkara. So Omkara is that Om that is Krishna. But devotees generally prefer to chant the Hare Krishna mantra, which is a more personal representation of Krishna. If we say Krishna, that very clearly is calling to Krishna, it's very specific.
It is always considered that, in Veda also it says that this fortune is to be born in a rich family. But I noticed...
In the Vedas it said what?
That it's a good fortune to be born in a rich family. To have a wealth. But I noticed that rich people, they're not at all interested in spiritual life, and that they are very materialistic, very samastic actually. So what is the good fortune about it then?
From the Krishna conscious point of view, to be born in a rich family is usually a disadvantage. Janma Ishvarya Shuta Shidhir Edamanam Napuman Naivarhatya Vitatam Vaiswam Akinchana Gochara. Kunti Devi says that birth in a high family, wealth, high intelligence and learning, and bodily beauty, these tend, people who have these opulences, they tend to become bewildered and puffed up. Therefore, they cannot understand Krishna, who is understandable to those who have no aspirations for material enjoyment. So the Vedas, they recommend that you perform pious activities and you will get these opulences, such as wealth. So these things are to attract materialistic people to the path of the Vedas. But they're not the actual purpose of the Vedas. That is just to attract the attention of grossly materialistic people to begin to follow some pious path. Because everyone in the material world, the conditioned soul, they want sense gratification. But the Vedas teach us that if you follow the pious activities of the Vedas, then you can enjoy very great sense gratification. Whereas if you perform sinful activities, you have to suffer punishment.